This is Scuttle version 2.4, and this is a newer design, version 3. I want to look at specifically the edge AI bracket and the rods that hold it. This is the computer of the robot. We are the fastest iterating robot design on the market currently, and we can do that partly because we have 3D printed parts. By adjusting the design swiftly, we can implement more optimal choices for fulfilling the design elements. This is called a DIN rail. Previously, we just had aluminum tubes. For the cost to be optimal for the aluminum tubes, we actually had to cut them ourselves to save money. And this means we had to have our own processes with safety involved and PPE involved and even waste that ends up on the floor and adds cleaning cost. The DIN rail, on the other hand, is cut by a simple mechanism of one push on a lever. It gives you parts cut in one motion. Foot by foot, one segment of DIN rail costs more than one segment of the aluminum, but we need to dive deeper. In the new design, we reduce two rails down to one rail because it can hold itself against torque on its own. We reduced four 3D prints to hold them down to two because we only have one rail. We massively reduced the training cost because it's a few minutes to teach somebody to use this tool, and it takes a lot of practice to teach someone to use that one completely safe. The whole philosophy of Scuttle is to follow the Toyota way. That means Kaizen, continuous improvement. We're making continuous adaptations to, for example, we reduce the cost of safety. We reduce the cost of materials by adjusting the design and the processes. We reduce the cleanup, meaning reduce number of staff required to make the workplace flow. Then you look at what does DIN rail give you on the design side? All these components, some are terminals, some are brackets, some are going to hold Raspberry Pis and other devices. These all come off the shelf. They're manufactured in high volume. That means the availability is better. That means that when a customer shops for add-ons, they can readily find DIN rail compatible devices and adapters on the internet at low cost in any country. So by making this change, we capture more customer preference, which is going to drive up sales. We increase the versatility of the robot, so there are more customers available who wanted to use the robot with existing DIN rail compatible designs. And then let's come to industrial compliance. These two components do the same thing. They take a 24 volt or 12 volt battery and they adapt it down to the voltage you need, like 5 volts, or in some case, a steady 12 volts. This is about $4. This is about $40. The difference is this one is accepted by the industry and it conforms to all of the industrial standards that you need to have in a machine that operates in a large scale facility that complies with OSHA and all that stuff. When we adjust the design from version 2.4 to version 3, we can still use the cheap one and we can offer that to our customers that want to have the best value. And then we can enter a whole new market space by using all certified electronics. What that means is that we can enter the market space where the $20,000 robots are being sold because we're achieving capability for industrial compliance. More revenue. What else is going on when we adopt the DIN rail and we can use these devices? Well, that means our design time can go way down. By outsourcing a highly refined, highly engineered component, we completely offload the task of design to the supplier. And let's be honest, we weren't designing this initial adapter. What we were doing was characterizing. So when we bring this device in-house, we have to run tests and do sweeps of voltages and loads and characterize under what circumstances will this meet all the needs for the robot. Our robot's designed to be able to take on many different payloads, some payloads that will take 10 times the wattage and 10 times the intermittent wattage than everything on the robot itself combined. When you spend $40 on an adapter instead of $4 on an adapter, these devices come from the manufacturer with very refined data sheets. That means when you want to design to add on some kind of attachment for your robot, you can just open up the data sheet and you will find the engineering data you need to validate your design before it's even built. What you're looking at here is a motor driver and a stepper motor that can drive high loads with precision down to a fraction of a degree in adjusting that shaft. The stepper motor can be used to implement designs such as this conveyor, where the whole frame attaches to a scuttle. It gets driven and controlled by the power system and the control system of the robot itself, and then you add an entirely new function. There are actually dedicated robots on the market costing $25,000, $30,000 that simply drive around with a conveyor belt on top. The past 5 years has been a process of discovering maker-grade materials like this motor and its driver, costing only a total of about $25. We verify that our machine is compatible with this actuator and many other favorites in the hobby space, which have a parallel execution in the industrial space. We also aim to adopt every component down to the connector, which gives us the maximum versatility to span all the way from student grade materials to industrial grade materials. But that design's not just about the parts. It's about the entire manufacturing and prototyping method. Those components, called Anderson connectors, just like this one here, can be used for industrial robust applications. What this does for us is it gets us the ability to use a $120 battery if we want to. We'll call this middle grade. Or a plain old scuttle battery that costs a total of around $30 and can be built by the maker or by the manufacturer. The truth is, both of these batteries contain the absolute state-of-the-art Japanese-designed battery technology within, which drives the performance. But now, since we've adopted both, we can allow the customers to take the pathway on a low budget or on a high budget. Or we can go all the way up to meeting industrial standards instead of the home or prosumer. We can introduce another battery of similar performance that might cost $250, $1,000, to meet all the requirements you need to be in the industrial space. In the end, it's about knowing what's inside the batteries and what drives the performance, and then making our design compatible with all of them. So when we ask, are we making the optimal choice for the best cost when we spend a dollar or more on a pair of connectors, we should be asking with a broader vision, well, we're reducing design time, because now we've conformed to a standard. We're reducing customer support because we know that the customers want to be able to implement a broad range of options on a robot, because the entire purpose of a robot is not to drive around, but is to create new outcomes. Just like your cell phone is not bought, you didn't buy your cell phone to make calls. You bought the cell phone that will give you the most options of what you can do with it. And the software just gets better and better each year, and we can adopt software from the leading software makers. We currently spend around $250 on parts for the standard scuttle version 2.4. And we sell starting at $550. We have made extensive benchmarking of the higher grade robots on the market at $5,000 and above, and to produce that variant of a scuttle would cost something around $1,000. However, it would be very non-optimal to exit from this market, because this is the market where we have a large population of very fascinating customers who feed back information to all of our other processes and design components. These are the ones that will help us optimize in an ongoing way. However, it would be foolish to exit from this market space at the $200 and $500 mark because we are building a community completely around the world with experts in different areas, software, hardware, manufacturing, and so forth, that give us continuous feedback into the design and give us awareness of where the parts can actually be sourced in the supply chain. If we were to make the robot at the $10,000 market range, it's going to be made of components that look like this. And the problem is, we will have a robot performance that relies on a particular high-end part that comes from one country that has its own tariffs. And if the laws change, if there's a supply chain interruption, suddenly we can't build robots. And what we've done instead is adopt standards that can be sourced from all over the world, any continent. Our global community is the group of engineers and educatees who make us aware of what parts are usable, discoverable, have tools that are compatible, and can be sourced in their respective countries. The community is the group that makes us aware by listening to their feedback. Where do they go as a second option when the Raspberry Pi completely halts shipment for multiple months? What is the cost of having a supply chain, including a core component of your robot, that cannot be sourced? I don't know, but it sure is less if your robot can use any of 5 different computers. Right here, you're looking at the encoder. This is the component of the robot that says how far has the wheel moved, and it allows the robot to measure where it's navigating. When you develop software that tells the computer to communicate with the encoder, on a board like this high-end Texas Instruments machine, there are at least 5 different ways you can make that happen. And the selection of the communication method determines how you hook up the cables on your robot, and it determines what functions are being called when your robot makes the communication. We are working extremely hard to make our software optimal. And what that means is, instead of choosing the method of communication between the computer and the encoders, which gives you the absolute fastest response on the communication, instead, we're choosing which method is going to allow a protocol that is so standard that you can make the same software function properly on a $40 Broadcom device or on a $2,000 Intel device. Understanding the favorite standards in the robot market between all the way from makers to professionals means that we're able to keep our design path for software and hardware along that standard. And that means if the supply chain gets disrupted, nothing happens in redesign. We don't need to perform more software redesign. And the customers love it. The only way to co-optimize all of the elements in developing and distributing a robot is to have experience that spans manufacturing and research and prototyping and education. And what else? Oh yeah, the most advanced form of manufacturing, which is digital manufacturing. 3D printing is not just for hobbyists, and it's not just for prototyping. It is the only way that you can iterate a design and in the same day have that component manufactured at any of a selection of thousands of capable manufacturers around the world with no defects. It is the only way to offload all of the sourcing and quality control processes outside of the company, for which we had an entire department at Toyota North America simply for localizing and verifying the quality of a manufacturer. Can you imagine what that does to the engineering costs? And what you have as a result is a design that is completely digital, meaning it is the only way that hardware in the future will ever keep up with the rapid pace of change as software has. And if we want to talk about scaling up and automating, by the way, a 3D printer is a robot, and digital manufacturing is the only way that you can have a robot building more of your robots. in 2022, what we've done with the margin between the sales price and the cost of our parts is continue to make our processes and our designs made from that which is fully digitally characterized, and make the selections of the components that have the long life cycles and have the absolute most characterized designs that are suited for digital manufacturing, digital characterization, and digital designs that can be distributed to team members around the world. By using global components that are off the shelf and backed by a massive amount of data, we approach a robot that knows so much about itself that it can use the inbound artificial intelligence algorithms to know exactly what it can do. It knows exactly where its center of mass is. It knows exactly the compressibility of the rubber on the wheels, so it knows exactly what kind of bump it can roll over without unbalancing the payload that might be balancing on top. It will know its own battery capacity. It will know how far it can drive on what terrain. It will know even how fast can it spin a tool without the reaction force causing it to tip over. It will be able to compute its own efficiency. It will be able to know how many minutes at what angle it needs in the sunlight to recharge using a solar panel. It is and will remain so compatible that the world's premier software developers who create the most advanced new artificial intelligence functions will be developing software that runs on Scuttle for free and giving more and more capabilities every year. Imagine a machine that can do everything that the Echo Dot can do, and everything that your computer can do, and everything that your smart TV can do, and everything that all of your power tools can do. Anything that runs on a battery. And we won't have to fund the development of any of those functions, because it is and will be carried forward by a worldwide open source community. We will never have to compete with the big institutions, because all we have to do is gain the favor of the big institutions by making our platform the most affordable, the most simple execution of a robot that will support their ongoing development of technology. And for any integration that does not seem simple, we will make it simple by simply publishing instructions in our library and making it easy for the users and for the experts to find the way to get connected into the platform.